right at your door. Buy local Wyoming roasted coffee at snowyelk.com.
The little old lady from Pasadena.
Go, granny, go.
Has a pretty little flower bed of white gardenia.
Go, granny, go.
But parked in a rickety old garage is a brand new shiny red super stock Dodge. And everybody's saying that there's nobody meaner than the little old lady from Pasadena. She drives real fast and she drives real hard. She's the terror of Colorado Boulevard.
It's the little old lady from Pasadena.
Nick, the Motor Guy, back here on KGAB, AM 650, KGAB. Going to chat a little bit about Super Days, because Super Days is going on today. And in the dunk tank, which raises money for the Cheyenne Mayor's Council for People with Disabilities, there are going to be so-called celebrities. At least they're going to be people who are really, really involved in the community. Right now, Rob Johnson, who runs my Fast Track store, he is in the tank right now. I hope he's getting extremely wet. 11 o'clock is Joe Shogren. 11:30 is Colonel Benetti. 12 o'clock is our own Glenn Woods, so go down and soak him. 12:30 is Brian Alf, of course, of Alf's Pub, does so much for our community, Gregorczyk. 1 o'clock, it's a politician, Pete Laybourne, he needs to go in. All right, 1:30, Landon Medina. 2 o'clock is Chad Brenneman. 2:30 is Sam Eliopoulos. 3 o'clock, if you got time to come and abuse me, yep, 3 o'clock, yours truly is going to be in the dunk tank and finishing up the day at 3:30 with Ron Clement. So come down, do a donation to the Mayor's Council for People with Disabilities. Great, great, great event. Great charity raising money for it. Please come down, soak these people, have some fun, have some laughs. You know I'm not going to be able to hold myself back, so we'll have a lot of fun with this afternoon. Hopefully I'll see you at 3 o'clock at the dunk tank at Super Days behind the community building here in Cheyenne. Everyone have a wonderful, wonderful, safe weekend, and we'll speak to you next week on KGAB.
A major drug maker strikes a settlement over opioids. I'm Pam Puzo, Fox News. Johnson & Johnson has come to terms with the state of New York ahead of a trial scheduled to start on Tuesday.
New York State Attorney General Letitia James announcing Saturday that drug maker Johnson & Johnson has agreed to halt the sale of opioids nationwide. The $230 million settlement follows years of lawsuits brought by states, counties, and cities against Big Pharma over the opioid epidemic that's claimed nearly 500,000 lives over the past few decades. While the lawsuits allege that companies overprescribed the pain meds, the drug makers say they've only distributed what was needed to help those with certain medical issues.
Fox says Karen McHugh, trials against J&J and others are underway in California and West Virginia. To South Florida, where a fire burning under a collapsed condominium complex is complicating the search for survivors.
It's extremely difficult to locate the source of the fire, and so they've been working around the clock.
Surfside Mayor Daniela Levine Cava, so far today, the numbers haven't changed. 159 people remain missing. 4 are confirmed dead. The cause of Thursday's collapse is under investigation. A few years ago, an engineer flagged a couple of structural problems with the building but didn't warn about imminent danger. As a result, a nearby sister building is being examined.
They are looking at, because it was built at the same time with the same designer, so they are looking at working with them, and I know they are considering potentially evacuating them.
Governor Ron DeSantis. It's been a rough few months for the airline industry as it grapples with hundreds of reports of unruly passengers. The TSA says self-defense training will once again be offered to flight attendants and pilots. America's listening to Fox News.
From from the Fox News Podcasts Network. Stay on top of the latest news and information from Fox News. Listen and download the Fox News Hourly Update on your time. The trending stories you need anytime you want it. Listen and download now by going to foxnewspodcasts.com. From the Fox News Podcasts Network.
What are the most important issues facing Americans today? Every Monday, join me, Brett Baer, chief political anchor and executive editor of Special Report, and my rotating all-star panel of experts as we discuss the policies, practices, and solutions to the biggest and most important issues of the day. You can hear new episodes every Monday. Subscribe now at foxnewspodcast.com or wherever you download podcasts.
The Fox News Rundown is a weekday morning podcast that dives deep into the major and controversial stories of the day. Hosted by the anchors of Fox News Radio. Subscribe now to hear a perspective of news you won't find anywhere else. Listen now by going to foxnewspodcasts.com.
The crash of a hot air balloon in New Mexico's largest city has left four people dead and another critically wounded. Police in Albuquerque believe the balloon hit a power line. This morning's crash has knocked out electricity to thousands. A close call in New Hampshire, where a man is expected to recover after being accidentally shot in the head. Police in Milton say a bullet fired by the man's 8-year-old nephew ricocheted after killing a chipmunk and then struck him. Police also say it's not illegal for anyone to teach a child how to shoot and hunt. Royal Caribbean is hoping for smooth sailing as one of its cruise ships prepares to leave a U.S. port for the first time since the start of the coronavirus pandemic. The Celebrity Edge will depart today from Fort Lauderdale.
The cruise industry has been shut down now for 469 straight days. It's been absolutely crippling to an industry that contributes some $32 billion to the U.S. economy. More than a quarter of a million jobs were also lost. But this is a time where things may start to turn around. This particular ship will leave for the Western Caribbean for 7 days. It will be 99% full of passengers who have been vaccinated. For those who haven't, they have to undergo a series of tests 72 hours before they leave. When they get here in the middle of the cruise and then after the cruise.
Fox's Ashley Webster. The pandemic is still hurting some nonprofits.
Habitat for Humanity usually builds homes to help the needy, but some branches of the charity are becoming needy themselves because the cost of lumber is skyrocketing. Jerry Leonard of the nonprofit's affiliate in New Albany, Indiana, says for one home last year, they spent about $2,500 on wood. This year, for the exact same home design, they had to spend $6,500.
Fox's Jill Nato. I'm Pam Puzo. Fox News.
Day weather forecast is brought to you by Bob Ruard Motors. Simple, worry-free car buying. All roads lead to BobRuardMotors.com. For your Saturday and Sunday in southeastern Wyoming, it's going to be cloudy, cool, and somewhat rainy. Isolated to widely scattered showers and storms today with more steady rains possible on Sunday. Could even get heavy in spots. Weekend highs will be upper 60s and low 70s with lows in the upper 40s, low 50s. Widely scattered showers and storms Monday. Highs again upper 60s, low 70s.
Speaking with Tom Laycock, Associate State Director for the American Association of Retired Persons. Good morning, Tom.
Well, hello, Doug. Thanks for having me.
Now, the topic this week is fraud. I'm going to bring up a fraud that I've been targeted with here recently because I know I'm not the only one. Somebody keeps calling my cell phone and claiming they're from the, quote, processing center and that I owe back taxes. I don't owe back taxes, and I know that the IRS doesn't call you, and when they do call you, if they did, they wouldn't call themselves the processing center. I will say, however, whoever's perpetrating this fraud sounds very convincing. Is this one you've heard of?
This is. So this is otherwise known as the imposter scam. So we see a lot of this, everything from IRS to treasury agents and even local police. And, you know, I mean, one thing that we tell people again and again is these folks will not call you with something like this. But this is an oldie but a goodie. And in fact, the IRS is kind of tired of it themselves. And so they're asking for anyone that gets this particular scam to call them. And I'll give you the number that they'd like to have you call them.
Okay.
800-366-4484. Or you can go to TIGTA.gov to report it. Because, frankly, they're sick of it, too.
So, Now, Tom, one interesting thing with this scam, I happened to post about it on my Facebook page, and one of my Facebook friends said, hey, they just called me too. Is there some way they could have tracked our numbers to get on this list because we're Facebook friends or anything of that nature, or do we know?
So we're not quite sure if that's the case. That's certainly, a possibility. But one thing that we've talked at length about with folks is the fact that in the past we've seen a number of, you know, what folks will do is they will go to a legitimate call center, mm-hmm. and just have that call center start doing phone numbers. And as soon as they get working phone numbers, those working phone numbers are sold.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
as soon as they get working phone numbers, then they sell those working phone numbers. And they're, you know, they don't necessarily know who they're sending them to. But it's certainly, you know, it's something that they can send to folks who are trying to pull the scam. People who are, you know, some legitimate people, as well as those who might be a little bit less. But they do pick up a set number of dollars per working phone number that they get. And so I'll get a number of the calls where people call, and it's from a number that you may know or may not know, and they call that spoofing, where they
right.
use someone else's phone number to make it look more legitimate. And I'll get the call, and when you pick up, you hear nothing on the other side. And mm-hmm. so one thing that we've actually done in the past, we had someone at AARP put together a news story on this for us, and it's actually worked pretty well for me to knock down the number of scam calls that I get. But pick up and don't say anything.
Right.
So pick a, you know, and you'll get the beep beep at the end, because what happens in a lot of cases, if it goes to voicemail, that comes up as a working number.
Uh-huh.
And so that will be, you know, tracked off to somebody else. You know, that'll be tracked off to somebody else as they're selling those numbers. So just pick up. If it's somebody who's legitimate, they'll say hello. But, you know, in a lot of cases, these tend to be sort of voice-activated robo-dials.
And I think you bring up an important point that I'm not sure everybody's aware of, although I think most folks are at this point, and that is just because it says it's a Cheyenne number or a Wyoming number, that doesn't mean it is.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's the beauty of the spoof. Is a long time ago, scammers figured out that folks are more likely to pick up if they feel like it's a Wyoming number, a Cheyenne number, or someone that they know. In fact, a couple months ago, I got spoofed for my own number.
I've heard of people doing or hearing that, yes.
Yeah. And I'm a jerk. Apparently I'm scamming myself. So that's kind of the next step with those phone calls.
One time in the not too distant past, it was a Cheyenne number. I picked up the number and I thought, well, it could be legit. So I called the guy back. He goes, I don't know. Somebody's using my number. So, I mean, they can use an active phone. As you said, they can use an active phone number. I don't know how this all works, but it's a new facet to this that's something people do need to be aware of.
Well, and, you know, you had mentioned the imposter scam, the IRS processing center calling you.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, I get a lot of them for student loans that I haven't had for 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the one thing we ask people is if you think it could be legitimate, hang up, find a legitimate phone number for them in the phone book or online and call that number.
Uh-huh.
If it's legitimate, they'll get you to the right person.
Absolutely.
So never be afraid to hang up and call a legitimate number that you can confirm is, in fact, you know, in this case, the IRS.
Now, in the past, and these scams were not quite as well executed, but I've gotten what sounded like a recording from the IRS. And just to clarify, they don't call you by phone. They mail you stuff, but not everybody knows that. I got a recorded recording that sounded fairly serious and fairly believable. Now, when I just to mess around with them, I called the number. It was some foreigners. I could barely understand what they were saying. That was not one of the more well executed scams. But this latest one, I've got to give the gal credit who left him, and she left a message on my phone, did it a couple times, and she sounded really believable. She was obviously a native English speaker. She sounded friendly, professional. So it takes some awareness on your part, and you know, you've got to be very careful with this, because you can get fooled if you're not careful.
Absolutely correct. Especially, you know, scammers it's a much more in-depth process than just calling someone and hoping to get their money.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there's really a hope that they try to appeal to your emotional side. And one thing we tell folks is if someone's demanding action quickly, that's a concern. That's a sign. If someone's saying, I need a credit card now, you know, take a step back because they're trying to get you emotional. They're trying to get you out of your, out of that place where the frontal lobe is working and you know, really working through the logic of whether or not this is legitimate and getting you to a place that's very emotional.
Uh-huh.
And the biggest one that we see over the last couple of years is that Social Security imposter scam.
I've gotten that call too. And I haven't even collected Social Security, but they either don't know that or don't care.
I think it's the second. You know, I'll tell you, in 2020, the Social Security Office of the Inspector General received over 700,000 reports of Social Security imposter scam, and 70% of the calls to the AARP Fraud Watch Network helpline related to Social Security imposters.
So this is extremely common then.
Very. And, you know, unfortunately, it's common because it's worked.
Right. They wouldn't keep doing these things if it didn't work, unfortunately.
That's right. So just remember, and it's a numbers game. I mean, they don't care if you call and yell at them and whatnot. For them, it's a matter of getting you off the phone if you're not going to take the bait and moving on to the next person.
Hey, I want to jump back to something you said a moment ago because I should have asked about it and I neglected to do so. Why should you answer your phone and just not say anything as opposed to letting it go to voicemail? Is there a reason for that?
You know, maybe it may come up as a deadline.
Oh, okay.
And at that point, that becomes a number that they're not going to sell to anyone from telemarketers to, you know, on purpose or otherwise, to an imposter.
Uh-huh. Now, I've heard of go ahead.
I was going to say, sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. You know, I've picked up and said nothing, and then all of a sudden the UPS truck has driven by and my dogs have let folks know that that is a working line.
Well, and speaking of the UPS, that brings up another scam. Apparently, I'm a scam target for these folks, I'll tell you what, because I've gotten one, and this one is a text message. It's not a phone message. I've gotten a text message claiming that my package from UPS was either on the way or here, and you need to click on this link. Well, of course, I hadn't ordered anything. But this is a pretty common scam, too, from what I've heard.
We're seeing a lot of that right now. And usually they give you a link to take you somewhere else, and it looks very good because it's not that tough to actually go through and re-put together a website. In fact, one of the big scams that we're seeing right now has to do with rental property scams. And what the scammers are doing is they're stealing photos of real properties off the internet,
mm-hmm.
and then advertising these rentals at a rock bottom price. And so you start talking via email, you find this terrific deal on a rental home, you know, down south where, you know, you can get away for a little while. And, you know, the big piece that we tell folks to avoid right there and then is the fact renters are asking, they're being asked for payment right away,
right.
Almost always through a gift card.
And that's a dead giveaway right there.
That's right. So if anyone's asking you to pay for anything through a gift card, stop what you're doing, hang up.
Well, and surprisingly, I've heard of scams supposedly involving law enforcement where you owe a fine and they're going to issue a warrant for your arrest if you don't send them a gift card right away. Now, common sense, in my opinion, would dictate that, you know, the Laramie County Sheriff's Office is not going to take payment on a gift card. But again, it apparently it must work. They keep doing it.
Absolutely. Well, and you know, so we did, AARP did some polling in the last year. And, you know, the question being, if someone directs you to pay a debt or obligation with a gift card, is it a scam? And it seems like, you know, off the top of your head, you'd say yes. But actually, 1 in 4 people surveyed by AARP got the question wrong.
That is surprising.
And we've seen a huge influx in gift cards being used as payments by criminals, according to the FTC, since 2018. That's a big one. That we're seeing gift cards, they're super easy to find, and they're virtually untraceable. And so as soon as you share that card number with a scammer, the money is gone.
Now, another scam, or another, I guess, mode of payment that these scammers will use, according to what I've been told by people in law enforcement, is go get a Green Dot debit card at Walmart and pay me with that. What's the advantage for them to do that?
once again, it's that same piece of it. It's the card numbers are real easy. It's, you know, these gift cards were put together so that you could share money quickly and easily.
Right.
And, you know, in some ways, unfortunately, they kind of they've made life a little bit easier for scammers as well.
Now, first and foremost, if it's a gift card, it's a scam. Hang up. What are some other big red flags?
You know, one thing we're seeing right now is a scam where emails or phone calls will impersonate a big box retailer and claim that you're owed a refund, and you have a phone number that you need to call or you need to click a link to get processed. What ends up happening in a lot of cases is you get to a scammer who will say, you know, hey, this is really great news. You know, I need to remote access your device and get you paid.
Right.
So they'll convince you to sign into your bank account so they can show you the deposit on site. And then they will actually take you to a fake page, which where they say, oh, shoot. You know what? I was supposed to give you $100. I gave you $10,000. So I need to get that money back.
Right.
And they'll do the thing, oh, my gosh, my boss is going to fire me if he finds out. So let's just keep this quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And then they'll take back the money. But the thing is, they never put the money in the first place. They just were able to get thousands of dollars out of your bank account. So, you know, once again, if they're asking you to purchase a gift card, it's a scam. Or know that you know, the big box retailers don't work this way. And if someone asks you to buy something to pay off an obligation, it's probably a scam.
Now, something similar to that, sort of, hey, you just won the Irish sweepstakes. You've won $2 million, but we need some money for processing fees. That's a scam, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. We're seeing, you know, we've seen that for quite some time. You know, but, you know, something else to kind of consider is just the fact that there are some ways that you can keep yourself safe from all this. And,
okay.
And, you know, a couple of things that we have told people in the past is, you know, three steps to keep yourself protected from identity fraud. The first is place a security freeze on your credit accounts with the three big agencies so no one can open a new line of credit in your name.
Okay.
My family's done this. It doesn't take very long. You do have to make sure you keep your username and password for it safe somewhere. But we have had, after we did that, we've had letters of people denying us new credit cards, people denying us Sprint phones. We've had a number of things where that credit freeze really saved us from people who, you know, through these data breaches can get your information, your personal information, and really with, you know, name, address, social security number or driver's license number, in a lot of cases that's about all someone really needs to open up a new line of credit. So we tell people, place a freeze on your credit. The second thing is establish online access to all your financial accounts, so your bank, your credit card, the people that you pay the most, and check them from time to time. Make sure that they're there. The third thing is we say use unique passwords for every online account. You know, consider purchasing a password manager that can create complex passwords. Because what we've found in a lot of cases is, you know, let's say that there's a big box store that has 8 data breach.
Uh-huh.
They have all of a sudden usernames and passwords. So What scammers have kind of figured out is people use the same password and the same username at a lot of other accounts. So if they get my information through you know, through a big box realtor in town, then they'll start going to the more popular banks and credit unions in that community. So they'll go to Blue and they'll try, you know, my username and my password that they pulled out of the big box. And if that doesn't work, they'll go to Wells Fargo and they'll try my username and my password that they got from the big box. So just go down one by one and until they can figure out where you're banking and how to remove that money. So that's why it becomes really important to use a complex password and a unique password for each of your accounts.
Tom, I think you've probably heard of this, perhaps not, but recently the Wyoming Department of Health announced that something like 160,000 people accidentally had some of their personal information uploaded to a website. Now, it wasn't bank account numbers. I think it was just names and addresses. Do those people need to be concerned?
I think if you are concerned, calling the Wyoming Department of Health is the way to go. I know that they did put out some information last week on, you know, there had been a few people that had been attempted to be scammed out of that particular data breach, but unfortunately, I don't have a ton of detail on that, and the Department of Health has offered up their phone number to help folks who have gotten into that place. Now, one thing I will remind people at this point is that, you know, the AARP has a fraud watch network.
Okay.
That's available. That's AARP.org and then /fraud watch network.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the services that they have there is they have trained volunteers who, if you feel like you have been scammed, you can call them and they will take you through next steps. They will talk about, okay, you think this happened, here's probably where you should go. In a lot of cases, unfortunately, they have to tell you, okay, the money's probably gone. But let's talk about how to keep you safe moving forward. The other thing that they tell us more often than not is everyone, you know, looks at these scam alerts that we do and says, you know, what on earth, you know, how could someone, you know, get not see through that? But the fact of the matter is, some folks don't, and because they feel taken advantage of or embarrassed, they just don't take any other steps past that. But we'd encourage folks, by all means, you know, if that happens to you, talk to somebody, reach out to local police, reach out to the Federal Trade Commission, which does a lot on scams, or call the AARP Fraud Watch Network. And so the Fraud Watch Network, it's free to everyone. You don't have to be an AARP member. You don't have to be 50 and over. If you sign up, they're not selling you anything. All they're doing is they're sending you watchdog alerts of scams that are happening in your area. There's a Fraud Watch map that once again tells you kind of what scams are going on in your area. And then they'll send you emails just with sort of tips and tricks for avoiding the scammers and fraudsters.
Well, and as far as being embarrassed, I would refer back to the scam I spoke about a few minutes ago. This lady was good. I mean, some of these people are professionals, and they make their living this way, and we're not talking about amateurs in some cases. They can make themselves sound very convincing.
Absolutely. You know, we almost, I was on Facebook and saw an ad for a cheap Patagonia coat.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, shoot, I'd pay that. And I got on their website, and I got almost all the way through the process. I mean, I was typing in numbers, the credit card, you know, ready to go. And then I thought, well, you know, that description didn't have a lot of wording to it.
Mm-hmm. Awfully vague.
Yeah, and then you start looking around, look at the you know, the address that you've dialed into, you know, typed in Patagonia.com to find out that the code actually costs about $300 instead of, you know, $60. And I said, oh, okay, you guys were close. You almost got me there.
Mm-hmm.
And so the little things in that regard, you know, because it is so easy to copy an image anymore from the internet and then rebuild, you know, a pretty simple website. So, you know, we just tell people to be as careful as they can.
Tom, are people safe dealing on eBay? Can you get ripped off on eBay?
You know what? I don't. That's out of my, that's certainly out of our realm of expertise.
Okay.
I'll probably defer on that one a little bit.
I did have a friend a couple of years ago who told me, and I got this secondhand, but claimed that he paid for a truck in Arizona on eBay and the scammers ran off with it. But I don't know anything more about that either, so I'll just leave that where it is.
Oh, boy.
Go ahead.
You know, Doug, one thing that has been a little bit topical lately is we're seeing that con artists are trying to take advantage of Americans who have received their COVID vaccines.
Mm-hmm.
By sending out fake surveys about the experience. So the emails and texts look legitimate. They even have logos of the vaccine manufacturers. But what they're trying to get to is your sensitive personal information. So they'll send you these surveys, and there's a couple ways to know that they're scams. First of all, if they offer a prize for participating.
Mm-hmm.
Second, the message says you need to reply right away. Remember, we keep talking about that. When someone's trying to push you into a decision before you're ready, that's a red flag.
Don't do it.
Once again, they want you to reply right away. And third, if you don't engage with the survey, if you do engage with the survey, you're asked to provide a credit card or other payment information. And so those are kind of your three red flags. If it's a prize, if they're telling you you need to do something right away, and if they're looking for personal payment information or a credit card. And so once again, those three red flags are really, they happen across, you know, a variety of different scams.
I would mention a couple others that I've picked up from my interviews with law enforcement over the years. One is, you're probably not going to win a contest you didn't enter.
That's right.
Which, I mean, that sounds simple, but I've known of people who fell for it. The other one is, if they tell you you won a prize, but you need to fork out some money to win the prize, that's also generally a scam.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, I think you absolutely nailed it there.
Tom, I got another one a while back, and again, I got on somebody's list. Unfortunately, I haven't actually given anybody any money, but apparently somebody put me on their list. I got a text scam claiming that I owed a $6,000 medical bill, and I had to pay right now. Well, I knew I didn't have a $6,000 medical bill, but again, that's another scam I've been hit with. Apparently, somebody's falling for it, or they wouldn't use it.
And once again, as you talked about, that you got to pay that bill once again right now. So people are trying to move you into that emotional space and out of a place where you can kind of take the time and do it right. So good job to you on that one. One other scam that we've seen locally as well as nationally, and this happened, we go to St. Mark's Episcopalian Church, and we had received an email a few months ago on this one too. There's a scam going around where criminals are impersonating clergy.
Oh, really? Now, that's one I hadn't heard.
Boy, that's, and talk about messing with fire there. the crooks post the email address of a faith leader, a pastor, a reverend, what have you, sends a message to the congregant requesting a favor. So that they're saying they're too busy and they're out of town. Could you purchase a dozen gift cards?
And these are real clergy people. They're using real names, I take it.
Right. Right. And if you do that, they will make sure to, go ahead and reimburse you further down the road.
Mm-hmm.
And now this also has been happening from scammers who have been able to spoof the email addresses of bosses.
Mm-hmm.
And so we've seen employees receive the same email from supposedly their boss. And so, once again, the things that we sort of encourage people to do is, ask if you've ever been asked to do a favor like this before. Ask yourself, would this person really ask me to do this? And then contact the person yourself and just get validation that they are who they say they are. And in other words, if my boss, Sam, sends me this email and says, hey, go buy a bunch of gift cards, would you? Just double check. Call Sam directly. Don't use the spoofed email. Just, hey, I got this email. It seems a little bit out of the realm for what we usually do. Just wanted to make sure this is what you wanted me to do. Do that, save yourself some money, save yourself some time, and perhaps some embarrassment as well.
Tom, we're down to about a minute left. Is there anything you want to mention that we haven't covered so far?
I think we've covered quite a bit of what's going on around Cheyenne in Wyoming lately. I just make another plug for the AARP Fraud Watch Network. Once again, you don't have to be 15 over to use it. You don't have to be a member. It's a free service, and it's, we got trained counselors that if you think you've been scammed, can walk you through next steps. Not to mention just, some basic information on how to keep yourself safe. So thank you for the time, Doug. We really appreciate it.
Thanks, Tom. Talk to you later.
All right. Bye-bye.
And welcome back once again to Weekend in Wyoming. I'm Doug Randall. On this segment, I have Cody Tucker with 7220sports.com. Cody, welcome aboard. You're newly affiliated with us in Town Square Media of Cheyenne. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me, first of all, Doug. I appreciate it. Really happy to be here. Really excited that, I started this thing in June of 2019, and obviously we've been in some very uncertain times, and getting on with Town Square just adds stability and longevity to something that I created, and it feels really good to know that it's going to be around for a long, long time.
I think there's a lot of interest in UW Sports, big market for what you're doing.
Yeah, absolutely. When I was in Michigan as a sports reporter, people thought I was crazy when I came up with this idea because, their thought is Wyoming only has 500,000 people. But they didn't understand
the forecast is brought to
whether
you
that's
by
a little
Bob,
bit
Ruard
or a
Motor.
Lot.
Simple,
so that's a whole state and no other state
all
can
roads
say
lead
that.
To Bob,
we don't have Wyoming
and
Wyoming State.
For your Saturday and Sunday in southeastern Wyoming, it's going to be cloudy, cool, and somewhat rainy.
They do well,
isolated to widely scattered showers and storms today with more steady rain possible on Sunday. Could even get heavy in spots.
Absolutely. And people outside of Wyoming don't really understand it. We're small but mighty, I guess is a good way to put it. People have no idea what it takes to get get to Laramie on a day like today, obviously. You know, what it takes for us to go 45 miles is quite a feat. So you're not going from Moreland or Sheridan, you know, most times to get to a basketball game, which is the reality where we live. So people do care tremendously, though.
Absolutely. Now, 7220 Sports, for those whom it doesn't ring a bell for, the elevation of Laramie.
Yep, the highest football stadium in Division I football.
And something we like to take advantage of by reminding people of that when they come from the lower elevations.
That's right.
Now, you mentioned the difficulty of getting to Laramie. How much is it a problem to recruit athletes? Is that tough? Getting your
high school. I mean, I'd imagine it's not easy. You know, it's the demographics are slanted a certain way. It's kind of, Laramie's kind of out there on its own. I know we take a lot of pride in it, and it's like, you know, Wyoming's hometown, but for a kid coming from inner city Chicago, maybe, or Dallas, it's a little different. But, you know, I think these teams, though, they're their own little community, and they bond together, and they're buddies, and they're, you know, lifelong brothers. And, you know, to be honest with you, Doug, there's not that many Division I opportunities out there.
That is true.
You know, and I covered sports in Houston, Texas, and all those kids thought they were going to Texas. They all thought they were going to Texas A&M. There's only so many scholarships to go around. So I think we've been really fortunate in Denver. Really picked up a lot of kids out of the Denver metro area that have really made a big difference in Wyoming. And Craig Bull, since he's been here, has made a huge effort to keep the Wyoming kids in state that need to be here.
Which didn't used to be the case so much.
No, and you can't win with a whole roster loaded with Wyoming kids. You just can't. And we know that. I mean, it'd be a cute story, but it just won't work. So it is nice to keep the ones that should be here, Division I caliber athletes. That's
call me, Rosie Harvey, at 287-0240.
Yeah, yeah, and also a great thing about Craig Bull's walk-on program is phenomenal. He encourages walk-ons. I think 33-plus walk-ons.
Or you can look me up online at townsquareinteractive.com/Cheyenne.
A lot of those are Wyoming kids.
Of course, when a Josh Allen comes from Wyoming and does well, we've sent several notable players to the NBA. That does help with recruiting.
Absolutely. Right now, it's so unbelievable still to this day. Remember back in the day, you turn on an NFL Sunday and be like, oh, there's a Wyoming guy. You know, it's amazing. Holy cow, I get to watch a Wyoming guy. Mm-hmm. Now there's 16 of them. Mm-hmm. It's harder not to find a Wyoming guy on TV, which is just gives us all a sense of pride, of course. And, you know, I'm a Wyoming guy first and foremost, so it does give you pride. And especially when you live outside of Wyoming, you can go, yeah, you see that guy? Yeah, I know where he went to school. He's from my state.
Good chance people might even know him. A lot of folks know Josh Allen.
Oh, Josh, for sure. But, yeah, a lot of even the other guys, you know. Chase Roullier just got paid by Washington. Mm-hmm. And Marcus Epps had some nice plays in Philly. And there's just one guy after another, and it's so great to see.
Tell us about yourself. You're originally from Michigan?
Cheyenne. I'm from Wyoming.
Oh, okay. Tell us a little bit about your background.
Yeah, so I'm from Cheyenne. Graduated from Central High School and went to LCCC. Got my journalism mass media degree at LCCC and then started this crazy ride. My first journalism job was in Warland, Wyoming, and still went to every Wyoming game, by the way, which was a 10-hour round trip on Saturday.
People do that here, though.
Yeah. It was brutal. And then ended up in Douglas. Spent a couple years there, and then went to a newspaper in Houston. Covered Jalen Hurts, the current Eagles quarterback, when he was in high school down there. And
is he a good guy? Or?
A great guy. Yeah. Yeah, and Alabama was on him like right out of junior high. Mm-hmm. So
that's the way it is anymore with the big time recruiting.
Oh man, especially down there. I actually took a pay cut to go from Douglas to Houston. But
are you serious?
Isn't that crazy?
That seems impossible.
Yeah, about an $8,000 pay cut.
Oh my lord.
Yeah, but I thought, you know, when are you going to get experience like this? Mm-hmm. I covered probably 50 Division I football players.
Looks great on a resume.
It does, and it was great experience because people do care. They care tremendously about high school football. Not that Douglas doesn't, because they really do in their own way too. But
high school football Texas. In the South is almost a religion.
Yeah,
Friday Night Lights is a big deal.
Absolutely, and the stadium was almost as big as War Memorial Stadium, the main one I covered. And you'd be in the press box, and they're feeding you like Chick-fil-A, and there's big screens that show the replay. And you're like, what is this?
So how did you end up back in Wyoming then?
Well, ended up coming back to Douglas after Houston because my boss was sick and he begged me. So I went back to Douglas and then did a little radio for a while. I actually moved to Florida for 10 whole days till our radio host got us fired. And back to Wyoming we come. But I got a job covering Michigan State University Athletics for the Lansing State Journal and lived in Michigan for 2 years. And my wife is from there, so it was kind of weird. We met in Wyoming, so it was kind of weird for her to move back, but it was a huge huge opportunity to cover the Spartans. And, you know, I covered Tom Izzo and Mark D'Antonio for 2 years. And
did you cover Kirk Cousins? Or
I met Kirk Cousins, yeah.
But he wasn't there when you were
No,
there.
He got inducted in the Ring of Fame, though, at Spartan Stadium when I was see. There. So, great athlete.
Well, and he's done very well for himself.
Yeah, he was. Who knew he was such a great football player?
Well, fifth-round draft choice. He's made his money and made his mark right now in the NFL. Yeah. So how's Michigan State, how's covering that different than covering the University of Wyoming?
Oh, just there's a billion and a half reporters that cover Michigan State. And then after Michigan State, I actually moved on and covered the Pittsburgh Penguins. And a million people cover the Pittsburgh Penguins, mm-hmm. too. So that's kind of the difference here. You get way more, you get to know the players better. You have way better access. And very
I can believe
for that, man. It's so good to be able to sit with a player and not just talk about X's and O's, but talk about them as a person. Mm-hmm. And then you get to relay that onto the fans, and then the fans feel like they get to know them. So it's been great in that regard. And you know, to be honest with you, Doug, I didn't miss a Wyoming game for 28 years growing
up. Oh, really?
And this was always my dream job. So I've always been fighting to get back. And people think I'm nuts that, you know, Michigan State's way bigger than Wyoming. The Pittsburgh Penguins are way bigger than Wyoming. But that's
not in Wyoming.
This is my dream. It's absolutely my dream job to say that I cover the Wyoming Cowboys. That means the world to me.
So you started this website, you said, in 2019. How did that all come about?
You know, I'd be sitting in the press boxes at Spartan Stadium and at PPG Paints Arena in Pittsburgh, and I'd be looking at these other guys who independently covered those teams, and I'd go, these guys aren't very bright. You know, they're not very bright, and their interviews are not good, and I've read their stuff, and but somehow they're making it.
Right.
I can do this.
Uh-huh.
So, and, you know, of course, it makes me sad, but newspapers are definitely what newspapers are now. And
serious decline.
Yeah, and it's unfortunate because that's my first love, but I knew I better get on the wave of technology, which I'm not into technology whatsoever, but I thought I better get on this wave or, you know, I could be possibly left behind. So.
Well, in the days of waiting for the morning paper to come out to check the scores, those are over with. It's not that way anymore.
Yeah, and my competitors over in Laramie at the Wyoming Tribune Eagle and the Casper Star, you know, they're pinched so hard. And now there's, what, Mondays and Tuesdays, they don't even print.
Right,
so if you think
right.
about it, if a game ends in Laramie on a Saturday night at like 11 o'clock.
Which is not unusual.
Not unusual. That is not coming out in the paper till Wednesday morning.
Right.
So, and I know they post stuff online, but you know, there's a lot of people who still want to hold that newspaper, and I'm with them, but it's, you know, the grip is definitely loosening.
So when it comes to covering UW sports, how do you approach that? What do you emphasize?
You know, my background is in features and storytelling, mm-hmm. and getting to know people and the real in-depth stuff. So, you know, I do the day-to-day beat stuff, of course, you know, what's going on. But, you know, we launched the site June 1st, 2019, and I knew right away my first story was going to be about Finnis Dembo. And we went down to San Antonio and spent the day with Finnis, of course, a Wyoming great, won a championship with the Bad Boys of the Detroit Pistons in the 90s. I knew I wanted him, and it wasn't just Finnis Dembo. It was, I knew that Finnis had, you know, a rough life after basketball.
Right. Tell us a little bit about that for those who don't know.
Yeah, so Finnis on Easter morning, I'm sorry, I can't remember the year, but on Easter morning he had a home invasion, and a guy was busting in his house, and he had his whole family in the house, including his elderly mother and his nieces and nephews, and unfortunately Finnis had to shoot the gentleman, and he shot and killed him. And it's something that affects Finnis so badly to this day. He couldn't leave his house.
But it's a no-win situation. The other end of that, you're Sean Taylor and you're dead.
Sure. You know, and I tried to talk to Finnis a lot about that. I said, you know, nobody would blame you. And he says, you know, that doesn't help. That doesn't help me. You know, he doesn't own a gun anymore. He has no desire. He, you know, he told me over and over, I took a man's life. I took somebody's husband, you know, and it is a horrible situation. And Finnis is just lights up a room, and he's such a great human being, and he still is. But man, what a struggle to go from winning a ring with the Pistons to having to do something so unfortunate like that in the childhood home he grew up in, where he still lives. We did the interview about 5 feet away from that front door where that gentleman broke in.
It speaks well of him as a human being that he does have that moral quandary.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, he's not, you know, it's easy to be a gun-toting and say, hey, he broke into my house. I'd do it. But it's another thing when you actually have to do it.
Right, talk to anybody who's been in combat, and they'll tell you about that.
Sure.
So you sound like you get more into the personalities and the personal aspect of sports. Would that be an accurate summary?
Yeah, absolutely. The biggest story in my career, and I don't know if this name rings a bell for you, Doug, but I did a story on Charles Rogers, who was a former number one
draft choice for the Lions. He was a bust.
Yes, and nobody had seen him in a decade, and I found him. I found him in Fort Myers, Florida, working at a chop shop, and my boss said, if you find him, I don't care if he's on the moon, I will fly you there the next day. They flew me to Fort Myers, Florida, and I spent 4 days with Charles Rogers, and it was the biggest story I've ever done in my life.
This is for me because I'm curious. Tell us a little bit about that.
You know, Charles had a really public fall from grace, as you know. I mean, right away you say bust. That's what a lot of people think of when they think of Chuck. But he just was going down a really dangerous path. Drugs, alcohol, all that stuff.
Happens a lot, unfortunately.
Yeah, and he had 8 children with 4 different women. And, you know, once he fell out of the NFL, I don't know about you, Doug, but back then when he got drafted, he's from Saginaw. He went to Michigan State. Then he gets drafted by the Lions. And I go, wow, that's cool.
High profile, number one pick.
Yeah. And I thought, man, that's really cool. He's got to feel on top of the world. And I was just a kid back then.
Right.
But it wasn't a good thing. The leeches are still too close to you. And that's what happens when you're rich.
A couple things about that from my perspective. For one thing, the Lions had a string of number one busts. Harrington, Charles Rogers. We could go on down the list.
Yep.
Secondly, that's just a dysfunctional organization.
It is. It is. And when you come from a dysfunctional family in the first place, and your buddies are your family, and they care about your money more than they care about you, I found a dejected, sad, about 30 pounds underweight. Which he was always slim.
Right.
He didn't look like an NFL superstar to me when I found him.
How sad.
And unfortunately, he just passed away about 6-7 months ago. And
I'm sorry. I did not know that. Sorry to hear that.
Yeah. It was just it was 4 days of, I didn't even know how big this story was going to be. And it was gigantic. It was all over the place. I believe it had 3 million page views in the first day. And it was all over the country. And people cared and people loved him and they wanted him to come back to Michigan. And unfortunately, he just never could face, you know, his friends and family again. So he kind of hid in Florida and just a really sad deal. I feel for his kids and his family and just the fans. They loved him. They never stopped loving him just because he made mistakes.
Well, and being a number one pick who, and I use the word bust, that's a little unkind, but being a number one pick who doesn't make it, we could look at Ryan Leaf. He's had problems. Jamarcus Russell.
Well, another guy I did a story on in East Lansing was Tony Mandarich.
Tony Mandarich.
Yeah, he was number two overall.
I'm old enough to remember that.
Yeah.
I remember when he... when
the incredible bust.
Yeah. And they called him the incredible shrinking man and all that.
Yeah.
He was a tremendous player in college. He was shooting the juice. We all know that.
Yeah.
And it's unfortunate because they were saying, you know, is he the best player out this year or not? And there was some serious dispute about that. We know now the answer was no.
Well, and think about that draft.
Oh, yeah.
Barry Sanders. Steve Atwater. Troy Aikman went number one to the Cowboys.
How do you compete with that?
Well, and when Tony got drafted by Green Bay, he said, I'm not going there. That place is a village. That's not even a town. He didn't even want to go there. And he went on Letterman, and he was so arrogant and cocky.
That's not new. I read a book by Jim Brown where he talked about in his days in the NFL, if a coach was mad at you, they'd say, we're going to send you to Green Bay.
Yeah, yeah. Or Buffalo.
Like being sent to the gulag.
Exactly.
But, you know, it is, there's a lot of human element to these stories. It's tough. These aren't, you know, I think it's easy as fans to forget sometimes these aren't cutout figures. These are human beings we're talking about. Human beings with feelings.
Yep.
And fans and writers can be very cruel sometimes.
Absolutely.
Unthinkingly.
But, yeah, and with a guy like Charles Rogers, I think most people would say bust first and foremost, but then other people say, how could you blow $30 million? And a lot of it was because he kept getting pop smoking weed. And people go, why? How in the hell can you? Why? You know, and it's a legit question. But,
Ricky Williams?
Yeah, but we're not in their shoes. And, you know, we just don't know. And with Charles, I did obviously extensive research on that story. And he didn't have a great foundation.
We'll put
it that way.
And I would assume there was some substance abuse issues there. If you can't stop smoking weed for $30 million, you have a problem.
And then two broken collarbones in a row, then that's when the painkillers came in.
Well,
and, that's a slippery slope, as we all know. But the weed kept popping him hot, which was getting him suspended, which was making the fans turn on him because it was like, dude.
It was just like the receiver, and I'm drawing a blank, that just got cut by the Seahawks.
Josh Gordon. Yeah.
And, you know, as a fan, it's like, how can you be so dumb?
I know.
I mean, the dude's got talent.
Yeah.
But it's substance abuse is a I believe it is a disease.
Yeah. No, I saw it with Charles for four straight days.
And like any other disease, it may not follow a course that's rational and well thought out.
Yeah.
Very sad in a lot of cases.
And just imagine throwing, you know, $30 million on top of that disease and not having a good family structure.
And having everybody know about it.
Yeah, everybody
knew. And probably remind you of it.
Oh, yeah. Every day.
Getting back to the UW sports, Craig Ball is an interesting case. He came in from North Dakota State.
Yep.
Of course, was Carson Wentz's college coach. He said when he came here that his main goal was to instill toughness in the Cowboy football program. I think we see that reflected on the field, don't you?
Oh, absolutely. And you have to be tough to run in his scheme because run is the key word in his scheme.
Right.
And he's all about running the ball and playing good, tough defense, and he's done that. And, man, the championships haven't been there yet. I honestly feel like that's going to change very soon.
I do as well.
Yeah, but he has put so many kids in the NFL. A kid like Logan Wilson, who is Wyoming tough to the degree.
Yeah,
absolutely. A Wyoming kid who came in as a defensive back and is now roaming the middle of the defense for the Cincinnati Bengals.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just he personifies Wyoming football.
Mm-hmm.
Toughness, nose to the grindstone, hand in the dirt. You know, I'm here to play ball.
Right.
And that's what he did.
What they like to call a blue-collar lunch pail attitude.
Absolutely.
As opposed to the superstar.
Yeah, and you don't see that a lot on Craig Bowles' team. Those guys
you really
are
don't.
Dancing, and you don't see it.
Well, it doesn't fit Wyoming either.
No. I think Rocket Ishmael's son was probably the most flamboyant, if you want to put it that way.
Right.
And he picked up a couple of personal fouls, and Craig Bowles' face turned very red.
What happened with him anyway?
He's just back in Dallas. Last I talked to him, he was hoping to latch on maybe with Canadian Football League, but nothing yet. So, great kid. I hope the best for him, too. And that's the beauty, honestly, Doug, about these guys. And I'm not just saying it to blow smoke, because I would tell you if these kids sucked.
Mm-hmm.
They're great human beings.
Mm-hmm.
They're all just so good. You know, and you didn't, covering professional sports like I did, you didn't always see that.
No, there's a lot of people in professional sports who are not exactly role models.
Right. But on the flip side, too, when you're covering the Penguins, you can hammer those guys. They make millions of dollars.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah,
if they
yeah.
slip up, you're in trouble with
absolutely.
The media.
Absolutely.
But college kids, you just can't and you shouldn't do it.
Right.
And but these kids are just, man, they're the, you know, Craig Bowl only recruits a certain kid. And he means it. It's not lip service or coach speak. These kids are legit human beings.
How do you think the new basketball coach is going to do, men's coach?
Love him. I love him. You know, all he did was come in and pull the number one recruiting class in the Mountain West. Wyoming's been nothing short of a dumpster fire for the last 3 years. He pulls the number one recruiting class over Zoom calls.
Oh, wow.
You know,
when you think about it,
yeah.
Different challenges this year.
Yeah, he got his first day when he signed on the dotted line was St. Patrick's Day. And we all know that's about the time the world went to hell in a handbasket.
Right.
All he did was go recruit the players that were on that squad anyway, face to face. The Hunter Maldonado, Hunter Thompson, you know, Kenny Foster, Quan Marble, the guys you wanted from last year's team to come back.
Mm-hmm.
He went and got those guys back and then just went on a whirlwind tour of pulling off guys, including a guy named Marcus Williams who's playing point guard right now. He's the fourth leading true freshman scorer in the nation. Really good, and these guys don't lose a year of eligibility, so this year is really a learning experience. There's been some, you know, rough moments, but they've already won more games than they won last year, and the trajectory is incredible. Jeff Linder is a very good coach, very good man. It's been a real breath of fresh air, and Alan Edwards was a great human being too, don't get me wrong, but that was not working.
The program went south, though.
It wasn't working.
On the court, the product was just not there. After a time, we had some success with the Cowboy basketball program.
Yeah.
And fans, I wouldn't say they were spoiled, but they certainly had higher expectations.
Yeah.
And it kind of all went south for a couple of years.
Oh, my God, did it ever. It just, and the fans showed it. I mean, it was like a morgue in there. And I know I kind of pissed Alan Edwards off last year because I said, you know, if you know Laramie, where the AA is, there's a cemetery across the road. And I wrote that there was more action going on in the cemetery than there was in this building. And he kind of thought that was a low blow, maybe it was, but man, it was kind of the reality of the situation.
And even just here in Cheyenne, just talking with people, talking with fans, I mean, the attitude got real bleak.
You probably couldn't even give away tickets, I'd imagine. It was brutal.
It was difficult, yeah. And that's something we do here. And there were times where nobody really wanted them.
Yeah. Oh, I'm a huge fan of sports, period, but there was times, even when I was just a Wyoming fan, that I didn't want to go over there either.
How about the women's team? What do you see happening there this year?
Oh, they're just always, you know, I don't cover them as hard, of course, but I pay attention to them a little bit. They're steady Eddie.
Yeah.
You know, they're always steady Eddie. They play good basketball, good fundamental basketball.
They had some good years there in the early years of this century, though.
Yeah, Joe Legursky was a real breath of fresh air.
Rock Springs guy. And when I was in Rock Springs, I used to work with his brother, Bob, who was the high school basketball coach. I was doing radio out there.
Yeah.
Bob was a great guy. I used to call him up on the road at 3:30 in the morning. Dude always talked to me. I always appreciated it. Well, in smaller towns, you build these relationships with people.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
And in Wyoming in general.
Oh, yeah. Douglas feels like a second hometown to me. I love that place. I always will. It always is a special place. I do, but Cheyenne's home. And
Cheyenne's
I've been fighting for a decade to get home. So it feels so good to be here. And my wife's a probation officer, so it's not as easy for her to find a job. And it's not easy for, you know, as you know, it's not easy for media people to find jobs all the time, too, especially ones they want and in desired locations.
Right.
The stars kind of aligned, and we both finally ended up in Cheyenne, and it feels so good to be around family and friends again and to be home. I mean, I fought really hard to get back to Cheyenne for years, so feels great. I love my hometown. I love this place. And if all goes according to plan, I'm never going anywhere again. I'll just go on vacations.
You kind of touched on this, but I think it's something worth hitting again. COVID-19, how's that affected college sports? How's it different?
How is it not?
How's it not?
That's a better question, honestly. You know, it was kind of embarrassing. I actually kind of broke down a little bit when they canceled the season, the football season initially. I was doing a podcast, and the tears started coming. It was,
you weren't the only one, I know.
Yeah, it was, you know, it was so embarrassing for me. I'm a big, tough, hairy, you know, tattooed guy, and it was sad. It was sad, and it wasn't just because of 72-20 sports. It was, how can Wyoming football not play during the fall?
Well, and then when they did play, the games get canceled there a couple. It was a tough season.
Yeah.
And tough in a different way than most of our players or coaches have ever experienced.
Yeah, and I do want to say, I think this gets brushed under the rug too much. These guys, these players, these coaches, the support staff, they got their brains jammed 3 times a week. You know, COVID testing so that they could get out there and play a season. And, you know, that I feel like I'd be forever in debt to them for doing that, because it would have been very easy to fold up shop and say, forget it. Let's focus on next year. And they did that. They worked their butt off. And as you know, a college kid not going to bars and not going to parties, like, they sacrificed a lot to do this for us. So it meant a lot, but it's been bizarre. I'm not able, unfortunately, to get a lot of those personal stories this year, and I think fans understand, you know, we have Zoom calls now, and it's
not quite the same.
No, and from what I hear from buddies when they're on the road with the team and stuff like that, they sit in their hotel. You know, I said, man, you're lucky you get to go to San Diego this week to sit in a hotel.
Well, look at the NBA with their bubble last year.
Yeah, it's not fun. I mean, they're not having fun, and it's all about work. And that's what I love about Jeff Linder, though. He worries about his players' mental health. They've been here since like June. And they haven't been able to leave campus, and they have to quarantine, and they can only be around certain people. And they, you know, around Christmas break, he said, I'm sending my guys home, and I don't care if they come back with COVID. I don't care at this
point. At some point,
they
gotta live
life. Go home. Yep. Yeah. They need to see their family. They can't even go up and hug their family after games and stuff. So it's just it's bizarre, and I hope the light at the end of the tunnel is getting a little brighter.
Cody, we're just about out of time. Any last thoughts on UW Sports, your website, or life in general, or whatever you'd like to toss out there?
I just hope fans check it out. We've been around for a while, and we've gained a name, but now we're on a bigger platform, obviously, and I really hope people check it out. I think the future of Wyoming football, especially, is extremely bright in the more near future, but I think basketball is extremely bright as well. But football, you know, spring ball is right around the corner. They're taking all of April. They're going to have a spring game in May.
Do we think we're going to have a normal season this fall? Have you heard anything? It's probably too far out.
Yeah, we just don't know. But I'm really hoping by September 4th, when the Montana State Bobcats come to War Memorial Stadium, things are normal and we can have a packed house. And I really hope that's the case, because there's nothing quite like a fall Saturday in Laramie
at
War Memorial Stadium. So,
Cody, real quickly, for those just joining us, where can people find your website again?
Well, you can hit us up on 7220sports.com. We have a free app, free newsletter. Please download it, and we'll bring the news, man. We've been rocking some news out. So anything Cowboy-related, you're going to find it there on 7220sports.com.
Thanks, Cody.
Thank you, Doug.
You're listening to Cheyenne's News and Talk Station, AM 650, KGAB, Orchard Valley, Cheyenne, a Town Square media station.
Hi, I found a toy dinosaur over on the playground by Smith Street. It had this phone number on it, and, well, I just wanted to make sure the dinosaur made it back to its little owner.
Yeah, hi. I think I found your kid's stuffed animal near the swing set. Just wanted to call. I'm sure she misses it.
I know my son gets super attached to the smallest things, even a fire truck, and I'd be happy to drop it off. The toy was a little muddy, so I cleaned it up, and it's good to go whenever you're around.
When I found the little sippy cup, I just had to give you a call. It's for a kid, you know?
We'd do anything for kids. Yet 1 in 6 children in the U.S. struggle with hunger. Help end childhood hunger and give all of our kids the meals they need to grow. Learn how at feedingamerica.org. Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
The census is a special time when we count every single person in the country.
Do kids and babies count too?
Of course. Counting everyone in your home helps support your neighborhood by funding schools, hospitals, and more. So complete the census by calling, going online, or returning your form by mail. It's totally private.
Visit 2020census.gov and
make your family count!
Brought to you by Carnegie Corporation of New York and the Ad Council.
1 in 6 seniors faces the threat of hunger, and millions more live in isolation. Drop off a hot meal and say a quick hello. Volunteer for Meals on Wheels by donating your lunch break at AmericaLet'sDoLunch.org. This message brought to you by Meals on Wheels America and the Ad Council.
Fire is hampering rescue efforts at the site of a Florida building collapse. I'm Joe Chiro, Fox News. Officials say that deep fire is slowing search and rescue efforts at the site of where an oceanfront condo collapsed Thursday near Miami. Fox's Steve Harrigan reports.
Making it harder for rescuers because of the smoke. Also, they always have to weigh what they do. By putting water on that fire, they are increasing the weight, which could cause more rubble to fall, putting at risk any survivors. So it's a real tough balancing act for those first responders.
Miami-Dade County Mayor Daniela Levine-Cava says a review will be done on other buildings to avoid any future tragedies.
At the county level, I am directing that our Department of Regulatory and Economic Resources will immediately commence an audit of all of the buildings at the 40-year point and beyond. So we want to make sure that every building has completed their recertification process.
4 people are confirmed dead from Thursday's collapse and 159 unaccounted for. 4 people were dead after a hot air balloon they were riding in hit power lines in Albuquerque, New Mexico. One other person was critically injured. Vice President Harris continues to face harsh criticism for her handling of the border crisis despite visiting El Paso, Texas on Friday. Tennessee Senator Marsha Blackburn.
Vice President Harris went to the wrong place in Texas, and it took her 93 days to get there. She should have gone to the Rio Grande Valley. She should have gone over into Arizona, where the Sinaloa cartel is passing all of those drugs across the border, all that fentanyl.
The administration says it's trying to address the root causes of migration. Harris traveled to Guatemala and Mexico earlier this month. America is listening to Fox News.
Jason in the House, the Jason Chaffetz podcast. There is always someone doing something stupid somewhere. Dive deeper than the headlines and the party lines as I take on American life, politics, and entertainment. Join me, Jason Chaffetz, every Wednesday as I shed light on the news and make some predictions along the way. You never know who will drop in. Subscribe now on foxnewspodcast.com or wherever you download podcasts.
Connect to Fox News Audio and the Fox News app. Listen to hear your favorite hosts like Brian Kilmeade, Jimmy Fallon, and Guy Benson standing up for what's right live and via podcast. Just click listen, then swipe right and hear the latest news updates on your time. And scroll down to hear the latest podcasts from Fox News. And it's even easier to listen in the car with Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Get programming alerts and notifications. Fox News Audio is on the Fox News app, the voices America trusts. Download it now.
President Biden and the president of Afghanistan have met at the White House.
Meeting in the Oval Office, President Biden urged Afghan President Ashraf Ghani to pursue peace in his war-torn country, even if most U.S. troops won't be on the ground to help past September.
Our troops may be leaving, but support for Afghanistan is not ending.
Ghani's trip to Washington comes amid what many see as a deepening crisis in his country. The Taliban has regained control of several districts. Defense officials telling Fox News the U.S. even launched two new drone strikes on Taliban militants hours before Ghani's White House visit.
Fox's Mark Meredith. The U.S. reportedly plans to keep about 600 troops in Afghanistan. Federal authorities investigating after men tried to enter the crew compartment of a plane at Los Angeles International Airport. Chelsea Edwards with Fox affiliate KTTV reports.
The suspect allegedly tried to get into the cockpit before opening that plane door and then jumping right onto the tarmac. This was a SkyWest flight 5365. Now, we're told that suspect tried to multiple times to open the cockpit door before, quote, exiting the plane. LAX police said in a statement that the male who exited the aircraft was treated for injuries and transported to the hospital. No one on board the aircraft was injured, and the aircraft was able to taxi back to the gate area.
The plane was preparing for a flight to Salt Lake City. The governor of North Carolina has decided not to approve a controversial abortion bill.
Governor Roy Cooper deciding against signing a bill that would ban women in North Carolina from getting an abortion specifically due to prenatal diagnosis of Down syndrome in a fetus. The proposal also sought to ban abortions on the basis of race or sex. The state's Democratic governor cited privacy concerns as a big reason for not signing off. Republicans argue that gender, race, and disability are protected classes and should be applied to the unborn as well. John Saucier, Fox News.
And I'm Joe Chiro, Fox News.
Day weather forecast is brought to you by Bob Ruard Motors. Simple, worry-free car buying. All roads lead to BobRuardMotors.com. For your Saturday and Sunday in southeastern Wyoming, it's going to be cloudy, cool, and somewhat rainy. Isolated to widely scattered showers and storms today with more steady rains possible on Sunday. Could even get heavy in spots. Weekend highs will be upper 60s and low 70s with lows in the upper 40s, low 50s. Widely scattered showers and storms Monday. Highs again, upper 60s, low 70s.
East Cheyenne's number one news talk radio station. You're in tune with the Weekend in Wyoming program. On the phone, I have Dr. Thomas Peter Martin of the University of Wyoming. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
I can hear you just fine. Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you well, thanks.
Okay, now, Dr. Martin, tell us a little bit about yourself, first of all.
Okay, well, I grew up in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And from there, I got my undergraduate degree in material science and engineering from University of Washington in Seattle. And after that, I went and got a PhD in material science and engineering from the University of Florida, which is a top 10 ranked engineering school. So my background is specifically in nuclear physics, but it is in
materials and materials design and things like that, which obviously are critical going into a reactor, no pun intended. Most reactor accidents happen due to materials failures. And so, after that, I came back and was looking for a job. My background is in the semiconductor industry mainly, but I noticed that the University of Wyoming needed somebody to run their transmission electron microscope, and I had a lot of experience with that. So I took that job, and I really enjoyed it out here in Wyoming. I love the climate. I love the kind of culture and the people. It's only a 12-hour, 9-hour drive from home. And, I actually enjoy teaching a lot more than I thought I would. I teach class several times a year on the electron microscope. In fact, I'm just finishing up one next week. So let's have a little bit of background on myself.
Now, Dr. Martin, the reason I invited you on the show was that you sent us a letter saying you have grave concerns, and that's the word phrase you used, grave concerns about the proposed Wyoming nuclear reactor. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. The primary concern I have is, there's two concerns I have. One is that because this is being sponsored, by the private sector. I want to make sure that the design is thoroughly vetted by somebody who has no ties to the people sponsoring it or their money. So basically, a third party needs to review the design in detail. I looked very closely online for everything I could find about this reactor, and it was all quite vague. It gave a few details that I was able to glean, but none of the more intricate design details that I might be able to say, this is a safe design or this is a not safe design. So I think there needs to be an independent audit of it for it's approved. That's one thing that concerns me. The second thing that concerns me is that this is a liquid sodium-cooled reactor. So a little bit of background is that basically every nuclear reactor has what's known as a primary coolant loop and a secondary coolant loop. And so the primary loop is what runs through the reactor core and absorbs the heat from the fission and the decay products. And they're generated in the core. And that superheated fluid then goes through a heat exchanger where the heat is transferred to a secondary loop where steam is produced, and that then drives a turbine and generates electricity. Now, in their primary loop, most commercial reactors use water, which has several advantages and several downsides. But this particular reactor is using sodium, which also has several advantages and downsides. The biggest downside is that, there's two downsides. One is that sodium is a very strong neutron absorber. It becomes highly radioactive when it passes through, say, the core of a nuclear reactor where there's neutrons present. And the second, of course, is that sodium is a very reactive metal. I'm sure many people have seen demonstrations where a piece of solid sodium is thrown in water and it burns very violently. And so, of course, liquid sodium that's been superheated, if it's exposed to air, it will also burn violently. So any leak in their primary coolant system will create an intensely radioactive fire.
So that's a big concern then by itself.
Yes. So they have to be very careful in how they design their primary coolant loop to ensure that there's absolutely no possibility of leaks. And they're going to have some kind of inspection schedule to make sure got the materials they build their primary coolant loop piping out of don't degrade over time, because neutrons do tend to degrade most metal alloys over time.
Dr. Martin, if sodium is such a concern, why not just use water for this reactor?
What they're building is something called a fast reactor. So water is typically used in what are known as moderated reactors. So when a neutron comes from an atom after it's been fissioned, it has a lot of kinetic energy. And when you have water in the reactor core, that acts to thermalize it, essentially. So through scattering events off the water, the neutron loses energy. And when it's at a lower energy, it actually has a higher probability of colliding with a fissile atom and fissioning it. So they want to use a fast reactor. So sodium will not moderate the neutron in the same manner that water will. So it'll absorb some of them, but the one that doesn't absorb will pass right through it and maintain their kinetic energy. And this allows them to burn up heavier isotopes of plutonium, let's say, than a moderated reactor. So isotopes like plutonium 240, 242, things like that are usually nuclear waste, can be used as fuel. And because it has better neutron economy, it actually produces more fuel than it consumes, so it's considered a breeder reactor. One downside of this design is because there's a lower probability of a fission event happening per neutron, they need to use more highly enriched fuel. So a normal reactor might only need to be enriched to, say, 5%. This might need to be enriched to, say, 20 or even 30%.
Okay, and obviously I'm just a layman and I don't pretend to be otherwise, so I'll ask what may be a stupid question. If that's the case, does that mean an accident here could be five times as violent as an accident with a water-cooled reactor?
Well, it depends on the mechanism of the accident. So,
okay.
In Fukushima, for example, several things went wrong. So they did shut down the fission process, but a nuclear reactor generates about 20% of its power from the decay heat of the fission byproduct. So when an atom fissions, it splits into two atoms, and those two atoms are generally radioactive themselves, and those decay, and as they decay they release heat, and that contributes to the heat generated by the reactor. And so in Fukushima, what happened is they weren't able to keep the core cool, and so the heat from the decay byproduct built up until it melted down. And then, because they were using water in their reactor, the zirconium piping, once it heated up enough, zirconium will react with water. And when it does, that'll release hydrogen gas, which then exploded. So that's what happened there. In this case, Bill Gates, the company TerraPower, claims that they have, quote-unquote, a passive cooling system where, in the event of a shutdown, instead of having to run water through the core, that just natural convection of air will allow it to dissipate the decay heat. Now, that's a claim they've made. I haven't seen anything in literature validating that their design can actually do that. But that begs another question, which is how well contained is this if it relies upon convection? That's another potential concern, is if it's open to the air essentially and you have air circulating through it, and then you have, say, a sodium leak, That would make it much easier for that radioactive sodium to escape.
Okay, I'm speaking with Dr. Thomas Peter Martin from the University of Wyoming. We're discussing the proposed nuclear reactor that was announced recently. And by the way, at 11:33, I'm going to replay an interview that Glenn Woods did this week with the governor about that reactor. By the way, we are taking calls if anybody has any questions or comments, 632-3323. So, Dr. Martin, if I'm understanding you correctly, you have some concerns about some claims with the safety mechanism that you consider questionable. Would that be an accurate summary?
Yes. So, I think, well, first of all, the easiest way to test their claims would be, to set up resistive heating elements that don't have any nuclear material. To a worst case scenario type temperature and see if the convective mechanism works. I haven't seen any evidence that that test has been performed. Another concern with that particular safety feature is that if it's using the natural convection of air, basically as the air is heated, the warm air will rise and draw in cool air, then it has to essentially be open to atmosphere instead of being in a containment vessel. And so if it is, then if the sodium primary coolant loop were to develop a leak, it would, as I said earlier, burn violently. The sodium would, of course, be intensely radioactive from exposure to neutrons in the core, and because sodium is so common in pretty much all life forms, it would be uptaken very readily if it made it in the atmosphere and precipitated out.
So this sounds, and again, I'm a layman and I'm not trying to sensationalize this, but if I'm understanding you correctly, this sounds like a potentially very dangerous situation. Is that accurate?
Yes, potentially, if the proper safeguards aren't taken. Sodium cooled reactors have been used in the past. I've looked at the history of sodium reactors. Several have been shut down due to minor accidents and sodium fires that were contained. The question is, would this reactor be able to contain a sodium fire if one were to happen? The other question, I guess, would be, what materials are they using in their piping? And a final concern is that, one benefit of a liquid metal cooled reactor is you can get away with using lower pressures because water, of course, boils at a relatively low temperature,
right,
and sodium doesn't boil until a very high temperature. So you can heat it much higher and get better thermal efficiency. The problem being that if the reactor is shut down for any reason, then that liquid metal coolant will solidify. And once it does that, it's almost impossible to restart the reactor. So a little bit of history in this regard. The Soviets in their Alpha-class submarines used a lead bismuth eutectic cooled nuclear reactor, basically, again, a liquid metal cooled reactor, and it gave great performance at a very small size, which is what they're aiming for. The problem is that whenever there was an accident in the reactor that called for shutting it down, then the coolant would solidify and the reactor was basically permanently disabled. They had to replace the entire unit. And so this puts a great deal of pressure on the reactor operators to potentially overlook encroaching safety concerns in the interest of keeping the reactor critical so that it doesn't essentially have to be rebuilt. So I want to make sure that, proper protocols are in place and enforced so that an operator doesn't push the boundaries of what would be considered acceptable in an effort to save the reactor.
So you're concerned about economic concerns overriding safety concerns in a nutshell.
Yes.
Now, Dr. Martin, this, of course, is all on the drawing board. It hasn't been constructed yet. They don't even know for sure where they're going to build it. Could they make changes in the plans for this to make it safer that would address your concerns?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, I haven't even seen the plans for the reactor because they're proprietary, I believe, at this point. I think to address my concerns, the primary thing that would need to be done is to have an outside consulting firm that has a good reputation examine this. They could do it under a non-disclosure agreement if TerraPower is concerned about their design leaking. But we basically need somebody who has no financial incentive to approve this or reject this design to take a look at it and point out potential safety flaws and then address those before building begins.
Okay, what sort of regulatory processes or agencies are in place to deal with a reactor like this? I don't know, would that be the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, or who would it be?
So, I know the Department of Energy has experimented with miniaturized nuclear reactors in the past. They build a lot of our submarine reactors, which are also miniaturized, obviously, because they have to go into a submarine.
Mm-hmm.
So they might be a good candidate. There's also the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. But given the amount of influence that people like Gates and Buffett and whatnot have kind of at those levels, I would say potentially that you might want to have scientists from both Nuclear Regulatory Commission or the Department of Energy and an outside commercial firm examine this. And the other thing that I would want to see happen is to look very carefully at the deal and make sure that the company building it is responsible for any accidents that might happen. I know that a lot of times energy producers are able to negotiate deals with the government where they become essentially immune from any lawsuits or other consequences of safety features failing. And so as long as they're on the hook for any potential release of radioisotopes or things like that, then I think it'll be in their best interest to make it as safe as possible. And I also think that having outside eyes who have no vested interest one way or the other very closely examine the design and potentially test some of these claims on their own would be a good a good safeguard. It's sort of like if you had a car company that was trying to sell you a car and they claimed that they had performed these tests and they say this is the safest car that's ever been built and it'll survive an accident, you wouldn't want to buy that car unless those claims have been reviewed by the National Transportation Board, for instance, right? You wouldn't just take the company's word for it. You want a third party to look in and verify that, yes, these claims are true, or no, they're exaggerating their claims. So at this point, I can't say whether it's one or the other. I just don't have enough information. But what I can say is there's sort of... what would the word be? It's sort of like designing a fireplace, right? It's a very good thing to have in your home. It'll heat your house. It'll do it at a good price. But if it's poorly designed, you can die of carbon monoxide poisoning, or it could start a fire, or it could cause other problems. So it has to be done properly. And so there's building codes for where fireplaces are built and how they're built. And all I'm saying is that we need something similar for this, because it's basically a giant fireplace that's generating power. The only difference is that in this case, if there's an accident, it could potentially affect a large region of the state, because even though the half-life of the radioactive sodium is only 15 hours, depending on the amount released, it could take many half-lives for it to decay away to the point where it was safe. And with the winds the way they are in Wyoming, it could spread quite a distance.
Dr. Martin, it looks like we have a caller. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yeah, yes, sir. I got a question. If it's so dangerous, why are we even building in the state of Wyoming?
Well, that is another thing that came to mind, is that if Gates and company are so convinced that their design is safe, then why aren't they building it in a state like California that already...
Bingo! Right on! Right on, dude. Excellent point. You have a great day, sir. Bye-bye.
So you think Wyoming maybe is being chosen because we don't have experience regulating these type of projects, and they might think that they can get it through more easily? Is that sort of what you're saying?
Well, I think Wyoming might be being chosen simply because it's, aside from Alaska, the most sparsely populated state in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And so if there were to be an accident, the number of people exposed would be smaller than if they built it somewhere else. And so their liability would then potentially be lower. That thought has crossed my mind. I'm not sure if their reasoning or their official reasoning for building it out here. I mean, obviously, if we can land this deal and, you know, get this outside income into the state during the state budget crisis, then that would be a wonderful thing for the state. But we have to make sure it's done safely and that we're not just being used as essentially a lab rat.
Dr. Martin, we're down to just a couple minutes left here. In summary, if I'm hearing you correctly, and correct me if I'm not, it sounds like you're not opposed to the concept, but you want some safety safeguards in place and some close looks taken by regulators who don't have a bias. Would that be accurate?
Yes, absolutely. For example, the sodium, when it gets hit with neutrons, it will decay with a half-life of 15 hours into magnesium. Magnesium is not soluble. That is one of the concerns that I've raised, is, I'm a little bit concerned that they're building it in such a sparsely populated area to start with. It makes me think that they might have safety concerns of their own. And by building it in a very sparsely populated area, relatively speaking, compared to the rest of the United States, that, they're trying to avoid liability in the event of an accident. And, that's not necessarily the reason they're doing it. I don't want to accuse anybody of anything without solid proof. But it is sort of a, it's not a red flag, it's at least a yellow flag. It's something we should be considering.
The forecast is brought to you by Bob Ruard Motors. Simple, worry-free car buying.
So Dr. Martin,
BobRuardMotors.com.
What's the worst
for your Saturday and Sunday in southeastern Wyoming? It's going to be cloudy, cool, and somewhat rainy. isolated to widely scattered showers and storms today with more steady rains possible on Sunday. Could even get heavy in spots. Weekend highs will be upper 60s and low 70s with lows in the upper 40s, low 50s. Widely scattered showers and storms Monday. Highs again upper 60s, low 70s.
Peek-a-boo. Smile.
Come on,
smile.
Honey,
he's still not smiling.
Maybe he's not a smiler.
Yeah, maybe he's just not a happy baby.
So maybe he's just being a boy. You know how boys are.
Or maybe he's teething. Poor baby. I think his gums hurt.
Maybe he's just tired.
Or maybe his tummy hurts. He didn't eat that much.
Maybe he's not ticklish.
You think maybe he's scared of the dog?
Maybe he'll outgrow it. Maybe it's a phase. Maybe he just doesn't like smiling.
Maybe he has autism. And we can definitely do something to help.
Maybe is all you need to find out more about autism. No big, joyful smiles by 6 months is one of your signs. Learn the others at autismspeaks.org/signs or see a doctor today for an autism screening. The sooner it's diagnosed, the better. And it can make a lifetime of difference. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
The thought of my sons growing up without me inspired me to quit smoking.
I talked to my doctors, and then I threw away all my cigarettes, ashtrays, and lighters.
I started exercising instead of smoking.
Getting support from friends online kept me on track.
Staying away from alcohol when I was first quitting was key.
Instead of smoking after I ate, I'd get up and take a walk.
I missed having a cigarette in my hand, so I'd hold a pen or a straw, anything.
Until I knew I wouldn't give in to temptation, I spent more time with my friends who didn't smoke.
I went to places that were smoke-free.
I didn't stay quit the very first time I tried.
I kept on trying, and I learned something each time.
Do whatever it takes.
No matter how many times it takes.
I quit.
I quit.
I quit.
We did it, so can you.
You can quit. For free help, call 1-800-QUIT-NOW. A message from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and CDC.
To retrieve samples, they discovered it was so radioactive from the sodium just in seawater that had been splashed on it that they couldn't go aboard to retrieve their samples. And a lot of data was lost because anybody sent aboard those ships would have been killed by the radioactivity. Mm-hmm. So sodium is a very, very good neutron absorber, and that's because there's only one isotope of sodium, sodium-23. And so odd-numbered isotopes like that tend to be good neutron absorbers, and sodium especially is a very good neutron absorber. And in this case, instead of using seawater, which has, a few grams per liter sodium in it, they're using pure metallic sodium. And so, one way to make this design safer would be to use something like a molten salt. There's molten salt reactors in operation, and the benefit that those have is because the metal is already oxidized, essentially. It's already not in a metallic state. It can't burn anymore. And so if there's a leak, then yes, the molten salt will leak out, but it won't undergo any further chemical reactions. Whereas the sodium, if it were to leak, would burn in air, producing sodium hydroxide, and that then would be lifted into the atmosphere by the heat, and it would form, for example, seeds and clouds if it got up that high, causing nucleation and precipitation, which would be extremely radioactive. By the way, for people who do know a little bit more about nuclear physics, it's a beta emitter, which means it emits a high-energy electron, and the half-life is 15 hours. So that doesn't mean it's only dangerous for 15 hours. It just means that the activity drops off by a factor of one-half every 15 hours. So if you had a massive leak, then after 15 hours, you only have half as much activity, but that could still be very dangerous. And so after 30 hours, you still have 25% of the activity. After 45 hours, you still have, an eighth of the activity, etc. And with the strong winds in Wyoming, if it did get into a cloud layer, it could spread for quite a distance if enough sodium leaked out and burned. So I think that the material that they're making their piping out of needs to be closely examined, as well as the geometry. Anybody who's ever worked with plumbing will know that elbow joints tend to fail just underwater. And of course, sodium is much denser than water, and it's going to be a lot hotter. And the material that it's flowing through is going to be exposed to a neutron flux, which is going to weaken it over time. And so I think they have to develop a comprehensive lifetime plan for when their primary coolant loop has to be replaced to keep it safe.
Real simple question, would using molten salt make this project safe?
It would definitely make it much safer. I mean, with nuclear power, there's always the potential for something to go wrong. But as far as I know, there has never been a major accident involving loss of human life or major contamination involving a molten salt reactor. And I think a molten salt reactor would be much safer than a liquid metal reactor. Just in my opinion.
So why not use molten salt? Is there an argument against that? Is it more expensive? What would be the reason for that?
Well, it is. I think the design would have to be a little bit larger. The molten salt might not be as neutron transparent as the sodium. I know he's trying to miniaturize this as much as possible. So, I'm not as much an expert on molten salt reactors as I am on liquid metal reactors, but I do know that India, for instance, which is suffering from growing demand for power, is using molten salt reactors. And in fact, one of the benefits of a molten salt reactor is that extracting is that the fuel is actually in the molten salt, and so as I said, the material in their fuel rods is going to have to be very highly enriched. So you have the potential for a leak in the fuel rods, and you also have the potential for a leak in the coolant loop. Whereas in a molten salt reactor, you only have one loop to worry about, because the fuel is already in the molten salt, and it doesn't have to be quite as highly enriched. And it's also much harder to extract from a proliferation standpoint than something like what they're building.
Okay, I'm speaking with Dr. Thomas Peter Martin of the University of...
I haven't reviewed all four locations. I would say that from a safety standpoint, building it in the more sparsely populated regions would be better from a safety standpoint. But you would also have to look at weather patterns, so what's likely to be downwind of it. So I think you would have to bring in meteorologists to properly assess that.
Now, in terms of nuclear waste, is that an issue with this reactor?
Well, one of the interesting things about this reactor is, so nuclear waste can broadly be broken down into two categories. The first category are fission byproducts, most of which have a comparatively short half-life. And are generally safe after about a century or so. So disposing of them long-term isn't as difficult. Now, the other category of nuclear waste are what's considered transuranics. So those are all of the elements heavier than uranium that are generated in a nuclear reactor. So things like plutonium, neptunium, americium, curium, things like that. And some of those have half-lives on the order of tens of thousands or even millions of years, depending on the isotope. Now, one advantage of this fast reactor design is that it's able to burn more of those up. Fast neutron is able to fission isotopes that would normally be non-fissile in a moderated reactor. And so, in theory, this reactor could actually be used to burn up transuranic nuclear waste from other reactors around the country that produce a lot of it. The challenge, of course, being is that you have to reprocess the fuel, which means separating the transuranics from the fission decay product. And that's quite an expensive process. So whether or not they're actually going to go through with that would be something you would have to ask them. But certainly it has the potential to not only reduce long-term nuclear waste, but actually eliminate long-term nuclear waste from other sites. So that's one big advantage of this reactor that has me kind of excited about it, if it can be made safe. So this reactor design certainly has its benefits. But like I said, the main drawback is the need for liquid metal cooling. Because liquid metal will not flow the neutrons the same way that water will. And, the choice of sodium as liquid metal is a little bit confusing because there's a lot of other metals, say potassium, for instance, that melts at a similar temperature and isn't as strong of a neutron absorber. It's a little bit more chemically reactive, but not much more. I think when you're looking at this kind of reactor, they've typically been used on in military applications before. So in things like submarines, where performance and size are considered paramount, and they're willing to push the safety boundaries a little bit because it's a military application. But for a civilian application, I think it might be worthwhile to consider expanding the facility a little bit and using something like molten salt reactors, which can also burn up transuranics and can also generate more fuel than they burn. And so they have pretty much all the benefits of this liquid metal cooled reactor, except you've taken away the chemical reactivity of the coolant. So if there is a leak, there won't be a metal fire. And of course, metal fires burn extremely hot. And because they're so radioactive, I have no idea how they would intend to put one out. So that would be a question that the state regulators should certainly ask them, is if for some reason your safety features fail and there is a leak in your primary coolant loop that starts a fire, what safety features are present to put out that fire before it grows into something that simply can't be contained.
So again, it sounds like you believe this project can be made safe. You just have some concerns about how it's being proposed at the moment. Is that true?
Yes. I certainly believe that this can be made safe. Obviously, liquid sodium reactors were experimented with mostly in the 60s and 70s. They did have some sodium fires, although they were relatively minor. They tended to be military projects. Those were, of course, done in military test sites, which were well away from civilian centers, and they were contained. However, technology, of course, has advanced a lot in the last half century. And so with modern computer controls and materials advances and things like that, I think it can be made safe. My main concern is that the only people who I've been hearing any design features from are TerraPower themselves. They write these articles and they get published in places like Forbes or in CNBC or other mainstream outlets touting all their safety features. But I think that an independent audit essentially needs to be done on those safety features to prove that they function as designed, and to prove that, or rather to establish a set of protocols should any of these designs fail, because as they say, you know, the best laid plans of mice and men and all that, even if you design the perfect system, you can have an unexpected failure mode that you didn't anticipate. And if that were to happen, you need to have something that will extinguish the fire and contain the sodium. And so the only way to extinguish a sodium fire is essentially something like a halon fire extinguishing system, which basically just smothers it in a compound which will not react with sodium. And it's gaseous. They use it in military applications. They use these kind of reactors. The problem being is that it only works in a contained system, like the reactor compartment of a nuclear submarine. It wouldn't work if your core was relying on convective cooling, and the convection was being done by essentially outside air, because then you would release the halon and it would just be convected out into the atmosphere and it wouldn't do its job. So I think that there's a couple of safety features that might be, perhaps the word would be self-defeating, if, you know, if push came to shove. So the convective idea to prevent a meltdown is a good one, but if there were to be a sodium leak instead of a meltdown, then suddenly it's working against you.
Yeah, it sounds like a sodium leak is your bigger concern. Would that be accurate?
Yes, it is. So I think that meltdowns can be prevented, obviously, by inserting the control rod. So normally a nuclear reactor is, the reactivity is controlled by inserting and removing rods that absorb neutrons. And so they insert them a certain distance to maintain the right neutron flux to generate the desired amount of power. If they want more power, they can retract them. If they want to reduce power, they can insert them. The problem is, as I said, in Fukushima, is even if you, what's known as scram the reactor, which is to insert the rods all the way to shut down the fission process entirely, you still have fission byproducts mixed in with the fuel that will be continuing to generate about 20% of the reactor's peak power, and that heat has to be dissipated. And that was typically done through water coolant loops. The problem being, of course, that if power fails to the pumps, then it melts down like what happened in Fukushima. And so the idea of using a passive cooling system that uses convection is a good one, but we have to make sure that whatever fluid they're using for their convective system is contained, so that if there is a sodium leak, it's all contained inside a sealed reactor unit and none of it can get out into the environment.
Dr. Martin, we're down to about a minute left, and I do have another guest coming up at 12:05, so I'll have to close this segment down. Any last thoughts for our audience here this morning?
I would say this. I would say don't be unduly scared of it. I do believe, as a scientist, that just looking at it thermodynamically, nuclear power is probably the future. I don't think wind and solar have the cut it from our national energy needs standpoint. So I do think nuclear has to be developed and explored. I just think it has to be done safely because, new nuclear reactors were put on hold for many decades after Three Mile Island. And so if a similar incident were to happen here, it would set the entire movement back by decades. And so this should be done, but it should be done safely.
Dr. Martin, I'm going to have to cut you off here. We are out of time, but I do appreciate your time this morning. It's been very informative. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
We're all part of your community.
We all play a role in keeping our community safe.
So protect your every day.
If you see something suspicious, say something to local authorities.
Hi, I'm Ice-T. As a veteran, I know that for many former servicemen and women, the battle doesn't always end when they come home. Every day, 184 veterans are diagnosed with post-traumatic stress, and sadly, 20 take their own lives. When nothing else helps, professionally trained service dogs can. American Humane, serving the U.S. military for over 100 years, rescues animals in need of forever homes and trains them to become free, life-saving service dogs for our nation's veterans. If you're a veteran or know a veteran struggling with post-traumatic stress or traumatic brain injury, please go to AmericanHumane.org to learn about their Pups for Patriots program. Let's give our veterans a fighting chance.
Adopt US Kids presents Multiple Choice Parenting.
You've accidentally cut your daughter's bangs unevenly. Do you A, line things up a centimeter from her hairline?
Man, oh man.
No, sweatbands are so hot right now. Everyone's wearing them, like that basketball player and that other basketball player.
B, get spiritual.
Mom, where did all the mirrors go?
A reflection could never capture our true selves.
Huh?
Beauty is within.
C, look on the bright side.
Less time blow drying, more time texting.
Or D, show empathy.
Mom, you really don't have
Ta-da! Twinsies!
I kinda love it. As a parent, there are no perfect answers. But you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
For more information on how you can adopt, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Adopt U.S. Kids, and the Ad Council.
No word in the English language is less convincing than probably.
Are you sure we should get matching tattoos on our first date?
Sure. We'll probably stay together.
Probably? It's been 23 minutes since I ate. I can probably swim.
You should wait 30 minutes.
Okay, now tell me what to do. Cannonball! Cramp! Oh, I have a cramp. I can probably hit the green from here. Probably. Can I get a mulligan?
Ready to go?
Hey, are you sure you're okay to drive?
Yeah, I'm pretty sober. Yeah, I'm probably okay.
Probably okay isn't okay, especially when it comes to drinking and driving. If you're drinking, call a cab, a car, or a friend. Buzz driving is drunk driving. A message brought to you by NHTSA and the Ad Council.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that our daughters have what they need to grow and learn. But that isn't the case for nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. that struggle with hunger.
Childhood hunger is a heartbreaking reality that Feeding America is working to change. Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste and provides it to families and children in need.
You can help kids in need in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Adopt US Kids presents Multiple Choice Parenting.
You accidentally cut your daughter's bangs unevenly. Do you A, line things up a centimeter from her hairline?
No, sweatbands are so hot right now. Everyone's wearing them. Like that basketball player and that other basketball player.
B, get spiritual.
Mom, where did all the mirrors go?
A reflection could never capture our true selves.
Huh? Beauties within? Oh.
C, look on the bright side.
Less time blow drying, more time texting.
Or D, show empathy.
Fox's Paul Stevens. Mom, you search really don't have
to. Twinsies! Near Miami
at the site of I kind of love it. Collapse,
but intermittent as a parent, there are no perfect answers.
But you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
For more information on how you can adopt, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, AdoptUSKids, and the Ad Council.
Dear Vet Kids, thank you for great experience and for your support to the military and veterans.
Thank you so much, VetTix. Our family has gone through a lot the last few years, and this gave us a nice break.
Every empty seat at a concert game or a special event is a missed opportunity to say thank you to a veteran. Give your extra tickets to VetTix. Give something to those who gave. For more information on how you can make a difference, go to VetTix.org.
Sensory sensitivity, repetitious behavior, lack of eye contact. You can see signs of autism in children as young as 18 months. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org/signs. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
Heat watches, warnings up and down the entire coast. Dangerous to be outside during the heat of the day.
You're listening to Cheyenne's News and Talk Station. AM 650, KGAB, Orchard Valley, Cheyenne, a Town Square media station.
Connect to Fox News Audio on the Fox News app. Listen to hear your favorite hosts like Brian Kilmeade, Jimmy Fallon, and Guy Benson standing up for what's right, live and via podcast. Just click listen, then swipe right and hear the latest news updates on your time. And scroll down to hear the latest podcasts from Fox News. And it's even easier to listen in the car with Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Get programming alerts and notifications. Fox News Audio is on the Fox News app, the voices America trusts. Download it now. From the Fox News Podcasts Network.
I'm Ben Domenech, publisher of The Federalist, and I'm inviting you to join a new conversation with the smartest thinkers out there about the country and where we're going. It's the Ben Domenech Podcast. You can subscribe now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, FoxNewsPodcast.com, or wherever you download your podcasts. This new show will feature deep dive interviews with newsmakers and some of your favorite Fox News analysts. I hope you'll join me. Subscribe to the Ben Domenech Podcast.
Subscribe and listen now by going to FoxNewsPodcasts.com.
President Biden has promised to create better U.S.-Cuba relations. Fox's Rich Edson has more.
During the 2020 campaign, then-candidate Joe Biden said he would mostly restore the Obama approach. Some Democrats are pushing the administration to fulfill that promise, though the administration says its Cuba policy is still under review. Other Democrats are urging the administration to keep up the pressure. The Cuban government continued restricting liberties and maintaining support for the Maduro regime in Venezuela. This week at the United Nations, the Biden administration defended the decades-old American embargo against Cuba, arguing those sanctions promote respect for human rights.
Fox's Rich Edson reporting from the State Department. Microsoft has uncovered a breach in security. Fox's Tom Rigotti with that story.
The tech giant revealing Friday an attacker won access to one of its customer service agents, then used that information to launch hacking attempts against customers. Among other things, they could see billing and contact information and what services the customers pay for. Microsoft issuing a warning to affected customers, saying the hacker belonged to a group they call Nobelium, adding it gained access during the second half of May. Tom Rigotti, Fox News.
The first race of a NASCAR Cup Series doubleheader is just getting underway. Fox's Matt Napolitano reports.
The Pocono doubleheader is back, starting with the Pocono Organics CBD 325. Kyle Larson will be on the pole for this afternoon's race in quest of his fourth straight points victory, looking to become the first Cup Series driver to win four in a row since 2007. His teammate William Byron on the number five team's hot streak.
They've been probably first on the average speed charts, you know, for most of the races they've won. So they've had the fastest car, and then their pit crew has been phenomenal.
Byron will start to the outside of Larson, Kevin Harvick, and Joey Logano on the row behind them. Matt Napolitano, Fox News.
And I'm Joe Chiaro, Fox News.